Drunken Universe, which is a translation of Sufi poetry, and, of course, Essays in Islamic Heresy. And by essays, he means attempts, and not just intellectual discourse. Anyway, so I hope to learn a great deal tonight about the non-official history of the founding of this nation. And let's begin. Peter Lamborn Wilson.
Thanks. JP, are those more people trying to get in there or what? I mean, should we let them?
No, they're not allowed.
They're not allowed?
They're suffering from strange diseases.
All right, okay.
Oh, one last announcement. These are flyers for events that I think might interest this type of crowd, this type of pathological audience. So I'm going to leave them out on the bench, and please feel free to take a look at them.
Well, good evening. Can you hear me in the back if I talk like this? And hello, Mr. Microphone Man. Is this level going to work all right for you? Okay. As JP said, this is an exercise in sort of lost American history. If some of you remember your college history courses in American history, if you took any, there may be one or two vaguely familiar names here. Chances are you never heard of any of these people, except Anne Hutchison, because there's a parkway named after her nephew. I think it's his nephew. Nephew or husband? I don't remember, actually. Some relative of Anne Hutchison is whom the parkway is named after. Other than that, she, of course, well, as I'll point out in the paper, she was the only literate upper-class person that I'm going to be dealing with, and therefore she's the only one who's remembered in history. And when I say history, I mean history in the sense that you had it in college. And because it's the, 500th Columbus thing, there's been a lot of activity now in lost American history. And a whole school of American historians, to whom my hat is very much off, have been working on lost American history since the 60s, which is when a lot of young people first got interested in this subject. And it really is a subject. It's a separate field. Some people call it, some people get lumped under labor history. Some people would get lumped under history of radicalism or something like that. But I see it as a general exercise that's been going on since the 60s in lost American history. And this doesn't mean just interpretation, although that's a major part of it. We are reinterpreting our history. We're reinterpreting now. We're in a revisionist process over Columbus now, as you must by now know. Everything that's coming out about Columbus is not all, high praise to the big white man from wherever the hell he came from, Provence, I think, probably. And that, that there was a downside right from the start to the whole Columbian project. This is in part being expressed by Native Americans, and they, of course, have a right to take the lead in this dialectic. However, they're not alone in wanting to see some kind of revisionist history of America produced. One of the great models for all of us, and I include myself only as an amateur in this field, is, of course, Howard Zinn's People's History of the United States, which was a breakthrough, and which, although it's a thick book, he still only managed to bring up as topics for future work a lot of things which are now finally being uncovered. A number of these historians come out of the British so-called labor history. It's a term I don't like. It sounds so laborious, And I would say rather radical history. People like Norman Cohn, the great Christopher Hill, A.J. Morton, all of these kind of older generation of not Marxists, but Marxist-influenced British historians are now—they now have a lot of young proteges on the American side of the Atlantic who are working on the idea that in the 17th century, well, the 16th and 17th century, there was something that you could call Atlantic radicalism, and by this they mean that the permeable membrane between Britain and America was really very thin, culturally speaking. I mean, there was a big ocean in between, and it took as much as 3 months to cross that ocean, but politically, culturally, linguistically, in every other way, that was a completely permeable membrane. So that we talk about radicalism, let's say, middle 17th century in England, and the middle 18th century in America, this is part of a continuum. And it's not only due to the fact that somebody like a Tom Paine moved literally from America immediately after the Revolution, when he already began to become a persona non grata with the high-ranking Freemasons who had taken over the Revolution, and went to England, where he caused a lot of trouble and had to flee the country with the help of William Blake in a famous incident, and ended up in France, where he helped kick off the French Revolution. So there were characters, famous characters, you can point to and say these were real Atlantic thinkers or activists. But there was also the whole underground of the Atlantic scene. And this begins immediately, as soon as the British begin to settle in the New World. I can't say anything about Spanish radicalism. I don't know anything about it. I don't even know if it exists. But it's quite clear that right from the start, strange radical influences were seeping over from England into America, and for a number of reasons which I'll mention in the course of this paper. So I think there's a whole new school, this Atlantic school of history now, rising up, very exciting. You know, you should absolutely keep your eyes out for works in this genre. Book just that I just read recently, Origins of Anglo-American Radicalism, edited by Jacob and Jacob, that has a beautiful essay by Christopher Hill on radical pirates. Wonderful. And Peter Linebaugh is about to come out with his book on the London Hanged, about all the... It's a socio-historical study of everyone who was hanged in London in the 17th century. But he's an American historian, and he's very much part of this Atlantic school. Marcus Rediker did a book called... That's R-E-D-I-K-K-E-R, I think. Did a book called The Devil in the Deep Blue Sea, about the position of sailors as very much a carrying mechanism, almost a viral mechanism for Atlantic radicalism. Because after all, they were the people who were going back and forth. They were proletarians. They were, to a certain extent, much more cosmopolitan than those who stayed at home behind, even though many of them were illiterate. You call them illiterate cosmopolitans. It's a kind of strange... kind of strange paradox, and it explains why it took until in the 1980s for research into the political meaning of what it was to be a sailor in the 17th century. These were invisible people. This was the scum of the streets of England, impressed into service. You know, these were proletarians. These were peasants who had lost their land. They were people who were deported for political or other crimes, political meaning always religious in those days. The sailors were a platform or a bridge, you might say, that bridged the Atlantic in this sense. So they played a very lively role in this new historiography that's being done. And as you can see, we've left specific studies of Native Americans here somewhat far behind. We are actually talking about immigrant and colonialist English radicalism now. Where the world of Native American resistance penetrates to a certain extent this world of proletarian radicalism of the 17th century, we'll get to in the paper. One final introductory remark, and I'll interrupt myself in the course of this paper, it won't be a straight reading, but I just want to point out something which I get to a little bit in the paper, but I definitely want to impress it very deeply, and that is politics is religion in the 17th century. All political ideology is expressed in religious vocabulary. And this is not just hypocrisy. Although you might call it expediency. The fact of the matter is there was no language of political radicalism to be used. The terms were not really invented until a Tom Paine came along, and that's already the end of the period I'm talking about. It's the first time you get like a secular radical thinker. Until that time, and all throughout the 17th century, which is one of the explosions of religious consciousness in our world, all political discourse is carried out in terms of religion. And radicalism, therefore, finds its expression in not in what we now think of as the Protestant Reformation, Luther and Calvin and so forth. These were the middle-class, middle-of-the-road reformists. The real radicals were way to the left of Luther and Calvin. They were genuine mystics, for the most part. As I say, it's not hypocrisy which led them to discuss, oh, you know, nascent class warfare in terms of the Bible. They really meant it that way. They were sincere believers, but their revolutionary aspirations were expressed always not only in terms of religious language, but even in terms of the organization of the church. How should the church be organized? The church played an immensely more important role in their lives than it does in ours. And I say the church, I mean the Church of England, because all the Puritans who settled New England, the Anglicans who settled Virginia, all the people who stayed home in England, they were all in one way or another related to a single church, the Church of the English Reformation, the Church of England. And for a long time, Puritanism per se was an attempt to reform the Church of England, not to break away from it at all. The people who showed up in Plymouth Rock were the separatists, so-called, were a very, very small group of people who had taken the final step of saying, all right, the hell with the Church of England. We are separated from it. Even Boston, even the early settlers of Boston, the Puritans as opposed to the Pilgrims, still considered themselves to be, in some sense, part of the Church of England, although they were being pushed gradually out of firmly out of the mainstream of religion, to the extent that they first had to flee to Holland, as you know, probably, and then to America. And the people I'm going to talk about are even to the left of the Puritans, far to the left of the Puritans and the Separatists, as you'll see. Left, right, these are modern terms. They don't really mean anything in the religious vocabulary of the period. I'm using it as a kind of shorthand. I hope you understand that I'm not trying to impose 19th century terminology on the 17th century. I'm just using that as a shorthand code, the whole left-right thing, to describe where these people were literally, where they were coming from. So the paper is called Caliban's Masque. That's Caliban, of course, from Shakespeare's Tempest. And masque, like M-A-S-Q-U-E, rather than just a mask, I wanted the double meaning of a play or a dramatic presentation, as well as also the meaning of a hiding of identity, a secretization of identity. I begin with a little quote from John Donne, who in 1622 was invited to give a sermon to the Virginia Company of Adventurers, the merchants who were responsible for financing the settlements in Virginia. And among other things, John Donne, the great poet and Anglican minister, said, "If those that go thither to Virginia propose to themselves an exemption from laws to live at their liberty, this is to divest allegiance and be under no man," than which he could think of no worse political sin, obviously. He was very conservative, reactionary even, was done. But he was brilliant also, and he had this insight into what was actually going on. People were going to Virginia to escape from law. For 100 years after Columbus, England did nothing in the New World but watch enviously while Spain harvested all its gold and spices. But Queen Elizabeth I had a court astrologer, the Welsh alchemist and magus John Dee, D-E-E-D, who dreamed, out of love for the Virgin Queen, of an occult British empire in North America. He talked up his pet enthusiasm amongst his most powerful and intelligent friends, Sir Walter Raleigh, for example, Hakluyt, the mapmaker and navigator, and Will Shakespeare. In a crucial audience with the Queen, the wizard, Dee, convinced her to promulgate an official claim to America based on prior discovery by King Arthur. This is true. This was the first legal document that was concocted to justify British settlement in the New World. Raleigh raised money. Maps, which like magic spells idealized the real world in order to control it, were supplied by Hakluyt. And Shakespeare later wrote a propaganda piece, The Tempest, to popularize the scheme. Prospero, in the play, was based on John Dee, very closely, according to Francis Yates. while the savage and unknown New World, which might indeed have been Mars or Venus for all anyone knew of it, was symbolized by the wild man, Caliban. The wild man appears in countless Renaissance emblem books and alchemical tracts. Standing like a shaggy caveman at the antipodes of all civilization, he also symbolizes hyle, or materia prima, the inchoate primal matter of the alchemist, the pure chaos which he hopes to transmute into pure order, which in turn is represented on the material plane, order, is represented on the material plane by the element gold. Caliban, therefore, stands for sheer potentia, potential power, wild and ungoverned, but also untouched by the corruption of history. Let him be converted into a Christian or into the philosopher's stone, as it were, and he will become the source of all glory and perfection, not only on the spiritual plane, but also the material, so that whoever controls this genie will gain both wisdom and wealth. And this double motivation was very much in Dee's mind when he was encouraging Queen Elizabeth to take a more imperialist stance towards the New World. Now, as it turned out, the New World was already populated by wild men. And the intellectuals of the Old World argued about the dual Calibanish nature of these so-called Indians. Were they subhuman cannibal monsters with faces on their breasts, as, for example, the wonderful artist James Herriot drew in one of the first picture books of the New World? You might have seen these pictures of the creatures that he heard were farther inland, who had faces on their breasts and no heads. Or were they noble savages? This concept, this exact phrase, may not have come into being until Rousseau, or shortly before Rousseau, but the concept was already there, the noble savage concept. In many ways superior to the corrupt, tired races of Europe, and needing only the light of Christ to obtain perfection in a single leap. What exactly is the state of nature itself? This is a problem that began, with alchemy, and eventually became the major political question of the American Revolution. What is the state of nature? What is man without the influence of civilization? Pure essence of humanity, what is it? Is it pre- or post-lapsarian? That is, did all of nature fall when Adam fell? Or had the New World at least escaped the sin of Adam along with the light of Christ? These were very important questions. Of course, Europe also had its wild men. Gypsies, vagabonds, rogues, crazy sectarians, barbaric Celts, witches, sodomites. In fact, the intelligentsia themselves sometimes seemed dangerously wild, all of them a bit mad and perhaps even demonic. Raleigh and Dee in their circle, known as the School of Night, were suspected vaguely of paganism and freethinking. Moses was a juggler, said damnable Kit Marlowe. Rowdy boy genius, Faustian pederast, paid agent of Walsingham, who was Raleigh's patron and the first spy master of the empire. In fact, the man who invented spying was one of this crowd. And in my opinion, by the way, as a footnote to that, the organization that Walsingham began is the direct lineal descendant of the CIA through Freemasonry. But that's a topic for another night. And Marlowe, of course, was also propagandist for Walter Raleigh's favorite herb, tobacco. He said, "Whoso loveth not tobacco and boys is a fool." And he ended up, of course, as everybody knows, slain in a tavern brawl. I mean, a really dangerous, a real beatnik. And a mob of torch-wielding villagers once burned down John Dee's cottage at Mortlake on suspicion of his being a black magician. So this whole crowd itself was very suspect. I mean, this was the avant-garde of the upper classes, for sure. Okay. The first experimental colonists in Virginia, that land of pure potentia, virginity and potentiality, seem to have been either marginalized intellectuals of this type, fascinated by occultism, which included then what we now call science, or else marginalized adventurers from the fringes of the Elizabethan underworld. Neither class proved overly fond of work, and laziness soon emerged as the Little Roanoke Enclave's major social problem. In fact, as Shakespeare puts it into the mouths of one of the characters from The Tempest, Gonzalo, he says, "In the Commonwealth, I would by contraries execute all things. For no kind of traffic would I admit, business. No name of magistrate, no politics. Letters should not be known. Riches, poverty, and use of service, none. Contract, succession, born, bound of land, tilth, vineyard, none. No use of metal, corn, or wine, or oil. No occupation. All men idle. All. And women, too. But innocent and pure. All things in common nature should produce, without sweat or endeavor. Treason, felony, sword, pike, knife, gun, or any need of engine would I not have. But nature should bring forth of its own kind all foison, all abundance, to feed my innocent people." So one can't help feeling that Shakespeare is definitely poking fun at the utopian ideal here to a certain extent. But I think it's probable that there really were people who literally expected that the New World would be like that. The Bohemian gentlemen, like Harriot, for example, the great mathematician and artist Thomas Harriot, who was patronized by Raleigh, wanted to write poems and fill their sketchbooks, while the colonists, the lower classes, seemed to expect nature to relieve them of all labor and boredom, as if Roanoke were a Garden of Eden. The intellectuals bailed out at the first opportunity and went home to publish their diaries. Several years passed before anyone thought to send out an expedition to this abandoned colony. And when it arrived, as we all know from elementary school history, it found the island deserted. What happened to the colony of Roanoke? Pessimists jumped to the conclusion that hostile Indians had wiped it out. And this explanation later found its way into American history books, and it's probably the one that you remember, if you remember any explanation. It suits the image of the wild man as racial enemy, treacherous and violent and deserving of genocide, on which our official U.S. mythos is founded. But it does not fit the facts of the case. The rescue mission found no evidence of a massacre, no bones, no burned houses. It found the colony's cannon carefully buried, and it found a note carved into a tree, "Gone to Croatan," or Croatoan. I'm not sure which spelling was actually used. There's two spellings. The rescuers knew that the Croatans were a tribe of friendly Indians who lived on another island down the coast, but for various reasons they failed to follow up this clue. Years went by again before a ship reached Croatan and found it deserted, and so the mysterious legend of the lost colony was launched. I might add here something which I found out subsequently to writing that paragraph, that when Sir Francis Drake paused in his epic voyage on the coast, southern coast of North America, I forget exactly where he made landfall, for some reason, seven or eight men left the ship and did not rejoin it. So there are some historians who connect the lost colonist myth not only with Roanoke, but with an even earlier settlement by these, I guess, Maroons from the Francis Drake expedition. Could have settled in and intermarried with Native Americans and so forth. So those are two possibilities for the mysterious legends of the lost Indians, of the lost colony, the gray-eyed Indians, so-called. In fact, however, I think it's safe to say this mystery was an illusion. There was no mystery. The fate of the colonists is easy to trace. Clearly fed up with slaving for a bunch of absentee London gentlemen, the lower classes of Roanoke had simply dropped out and gone native. They moved to Croatan and joined the tribe, and then moved again later to the mainland near the Great Dismal Swamp. And their movements there can be traced, actually. where they avoided discovery for a long time. In other words, where they finally disappeared from the notice of official history, and subsequently gave rise to these famous rumors of gray-eyed Indians. Later, this group absorbed runaway slaves into their population and survived as a so-called triracial isolate community for centuries. That means red, white, and black, a triracial isolate community. I don't like this phrase at all. I wish I could think of a better term. It means white, red, and black mixed group that closes in on itself and becomes a tribe. And we have a lot of such groups on the whole eastern coast area of America. But that, again, that's a topic for another paper. In fact, the Croatans are still there. They still have some of the family names of the Roanoke colonists, which, in my opinion, is probably the best proof that this legend is in fact true. And they, at any rate, still know exactly who they are. The hideously embarrassing fact is that North America's very first colonists had decided to become wild men. European vagabonds transmuted themselves into noble savages, said goodbye to occult imperialism and the miseries of civilization, and took to the forest. I say men here, by the way, so far, because there are no women involved yet. These are all white men here so far. Nor were they the last to follow this path into the heart of darkness. For the next century or so, a hidden and secret struggle was waged for the future becoming of the New World. Cotton Mather called it invisible warfare. He was one of the enemies, but he was smart enough to realize what was going on. It was a many-sided affair. First, we have the imperialists, the Anglican aristocrats, the proto-scientists, the Renaissance classicists, the School of Night, Raleigh and his gang. Then we have the Puritans, who became the ruling elite in Massachusetts, who viewed nature as a howling wilderness and the red man as a devil, and I mean that literally. Then we have the Indians themselves. We have the first beginnings of black slavery. And finally, we have the dregs, the so-called dregs of European society, the outcast criminals, prostitutes, that is to say, poor women, radical mystical dissidents, neo-pagans and witches, indentured servants, Irish rebels, buccaneers, etc., etc. And all of this latter group, I suppose for want of a better word, we can call the proletarians, sometimes found common cause with Indians and slaves, and always a common hatred for the gentry and Puritans. Skipping ahead a little in the story, so an incident which I don't think I mentioned in the paper. If I did, I apologize since I'll be reading it twice, but just in case I didn't put this in. In 1740, there was a riot in New York City in which Irish, and mostly Irish, but some English, black freedmen and Native Americans all took part, and this conspiracy to start the riot was actually busted, and there was a trial, and most of the ringleaders were hanged. And during the trial, one of the Irish conspirators was quoted as saying, "Let's go out and see how many white people we can kill." The interesting fact of the matter is that what we now think of as American racism had not yet come into being in any of the senses that we really know it. I mean, yes, there was racism, but at the bottom of the American mélange was this, as I say, we don't have a better word than proletarian, plebeian, I don't know, lower classes, whatever. They were called the lower sort was the politest term that was used for them in the period. Scum was the usual term. Who found really not only just, you know, this is not a romantic looking back on the past when I say that whites, blacks, and reds found common cause in their oppression. They literally did. Not only did they intermarry, they also launched rebellions together. Didn't really consider themselves to be part of the same group as the white oppressors. In other words, the Irish and lower class English people who participated in these riots did not consider themselves to be at all part of the same world as the London aristocrats who were running the show. or the Puritan or the middle class Puritan merchants who were running the show in the New World. They were outcasts, and there was a great degree of solidarity amongst these different groups, which has been erased by modern American historians who want to interpret the entire of American history in terms of racial separation and hatred. Well, you know, it's not a category that applies to the 16th and 17th century in precisely that way. And again, this is one of the revisionist tasks of this school of history that I talked about. All right, sorry, where was I here? Let's see. Oh, yes. We could trace the submerged story of this struggle by various sets of signs, social, economic, historical, even military. But a different approach may offer us a better chance to discern underlying ideologies in this warfare, the technique of history of religions. 16th, 17th century thinkers thought in religious language, and I don't apologize for repeating this, I consider it so important, not modern political cultural language. And if we wish to understand their politics and culture, we must try to decode their language. There existed what may be called a church of the wild man in America, a religion of wildness or wilderness, opposed both to the high church of Virginia and the low church of Massachusetts, a dissidence within Protestant dissidents, and one which has been almost ignored by history. After all, history is written by those who believe in history, but the wild men are attempting to escape from history, and so they do not write it. Or if they do, they write poetry or wild rants. And so, as the Persians like to say, the pen is in the hand of the enemy. Who writes about these people? The winners in all struggles are the ones who get to write the history. We can recover only scattered shards, folklore and rumor, the Hebrew-phrenic tracts of crackpot heretics. But out of these broken pieces, we can assemble some sort of pattern. The first canonization bestowed by our invisible anti-church belongs by right to Thomas Morton of Marymount. M-O-R-T-O-N. Morton came of minor West Country gentry stock, had a passable education, attended the Inns of Fields for a couple of years, could boast of contacts in the School of Knight. His patron, Sir Ferdinando Gorges, or Gorges, I've never have been quite sure how that name is pronounced, G-O-R-G-E-S, was a close associate of the Raleigh clique. In fact, he was a member of the Raleigh clique. So here we have a minor member of the gentry whom I was discussing. He arrived in Massachusetts at Plymouth Bay Colony in 1624, very, very early, and soon fell afoul of the dour and precise, as he called them, sectarians. Now, Morton had begun life as an Anglican and a royalist, as you could say, about as conservative as you could get in terms of English politics at the time. Another one of his patrons was the famous Archbishop Laud, who was executed by the Puritans during the Puritan Revolution. So he begins, we have to begin by looking at Morton not only as a member of the gentry, but even as a reactionary member of the gentry. But in the New World, these conservative instincts put him in a marginal position vis-a-vis the local elite, the Pilgrim Fathers under Governor Bradford. I'll explain this. In truth, Morton seems to have been something of a crypto-pagan, not only by heritage, for the English countryside still preserved ancient British customs, but also by conviction. And again, after I wrote this, I found out that Archbishop Laud and this whole party of gentry had promulgated what they called the Book of Sports, which was to be read out in the churches, in Anglican churches. And what this was a tract that spoke highly in favor and encouraged all the old English Sunday sports, including maypoles and other pagan survivals. And it was the high church party that was in favor of this. The Puritans detested it. They thought that all this bear baiting and ale drinking and maypole dancing was intolerable Romanism and paganism. And so here we have a very peculiar paradox and a beautiful example in my mind of why we cannot think of the past simply in terms of modern left-right politics. On the one hand, you have the most reactionary party in England, the Laudians, who were propagating a view of life that said, for example, that wanted 100 saint days, holidays in the year, 100 days when nobody would work. And who, for example, were dead set against enclosure, if you know what that's all about. It was Archbishop Laud who fought enclosure and the Puritans who liked it. So a lot of things which we've now come to think of as radical positions, like being anti-enclosure, were actually positions that were held by the reactionary right, you know, in order to, again, to use terms, modern terms, which don't really apply. So there was this, what you might call, a utopian trace in the Laudian party, and it very much influenced Mr. Morton, who was a real a wild and woolly example of this type of Englishman. He was not, by nature, clearly not an authoritarian, Laudian, Anglican minister. In fact, he probably came to the New World because he was as unacceptable to his own party as he was to the other. As we'll see, he's someone who took this stuff really seriously. As a Renaissance gentleman, he preferred Greco-Roman mythology to the Bible. And this you can prove by reading his book, in which there's many, many more references to Greco-Roman culture than to Christian culture. And in this sense, this was a taste that he shared with Sidney and Spencer, and perhaps even Shakespeare, and other members and associates of the School of Night, who, as I mentioned before, were suspected of being neo-pagans, probably with some reason. It was through this kind of mix of ideologies that Morton justified, or seems to have justified, his value system of humane libertinism. In his writings, he invariably refers to himself in the third person as mine host of Marymount, or as he spells it, M-A-R-E, Mount, with a cluster of puns around his chief obsession and key term, Mary, or merriment. And again, I keep on finding more and more evidence of this, of my interpretation of his character. It's very interesting. It was very interesting of me to read just last night that Gerald Winstanley, the famous digger, who represented the extreme left-wing opposition to Parliament during the Puritan Revolution, once went so far as to say that England had been a far merrier place before the Reformation. And this is what he was talking about. He was talking about the fact that there were 100 saints' days holidays in the year, that their ale flowed freely. Winstanley was not one of these dour sectarian Puritans. He was very much a pro-life, pro-happiness kind of guy. He's a character who needs to be rethought by history for sure. But this term merry is very important in 17th century ideology, whether England should be merry or not. Now it's just a cliche. We talk about merry old England. What do we mean? Where did that concept come from? Why is it such a deeply embedded concept in our language? Because there was this terrific fight in the 17th century, the first century of the modern age, in which the whole issue was, would England remain merry or would it fall under the spell of Puritanism, one way or another? And as we'll see, that battle, which didn't really come to a head in England until the 1640s, was played out here in America in the 1620s. It was pre-acted by Thomas Morton and Governor Bradford, and now I'll tell you how it happened. Near Mount Wollaston in the wilderness, and this is a modern-day suburb of Boston, Morton dropped out and built a trading post and a tavern, where he soon gathered around him a small Comus crew, if I can steal a phrase from Milton, of disaffected fur traders, antinomians, loose women, Indians, and bon vivants. Now, another very interesting point is that Morton got on extremely well with the Indians, whom he much preferred to the Puritans. And in fact, when he named his book, he named his settlement New Canaan, and he called his book New Canaan. And what he meant by that was a very interesting dig at Christianity, especially at the Puritans, of course, considered themselves the new Israelites. And the new world was Zion, the new Zion. So how did the Israelites conquer Israel? They took it away from the Canaanites. Remember your Bible. They crushed the Canaanites and moved into Israel. Morton identified the American Indians with the Canaanites. And that's why he called his settlement New Canaan, and that's why he called his book New Canaan. All right. In his mind, the natives were... In his mind, the natives were like the pagan Canaanites who'd been slaughtered and oppressed by the Israelites of the Old Testament, and if the pilgrims claimed to be the Israelites of this new holy land, Morton's sympathies would lie entirely with those red-skinned Canaanites. In 1627, he erected a huge maypole, an 80-foot pine trunk topped with a set of deer antlers, and proclaimed the revels of New Canaan at Marymount, and invited his white and Indian friends to the first interracial neo-pagan be-in in America. In his account of these events, Morton declares that Cupid's mother inspired him with proclamation, this is a quote, with proclamation that the 1st of May at Marymount shall be kept holiday. Of course, you know what May Day is now, and this is how it starts. But, he goes on, this is Morton's quote from Morton's book, the setting up of this maypole was a lamentable spectacle to the precise separatists that lived at New Plymouth. They termed it an idol. Yea, they called it the Calf of Horeb, and stood at defiance with the place, naming it Mount Dagon, threatening to make it a woeful mount and not a merry mount. Morton's New World experiences had turned him from an old-fashioned rural squire into a raving radical, or rather, the New World itself had changed the meaning of his life for him and revealed to him his own interconnection with the wilderness and the wildness. No wonder the pilgrims recoiled in horror to find Morton and his friends dancing hand in hand around the maypole, quote, whilst one of the company sung and filled out the good liquor like Ganymedes and Jupiter, that is to say, like Ganymede and Jupiter. A little reference to homosexuality there. Here's the song they sang, according to Morton. Drink and be merry, 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 boys. Let all your delight be in Hymen's joys. Eo to Hymen, now the day is come. About the merry maypole, take a room. I don't know what that means. Make green garlands, bring bottles out, and fill sweet nectar freely about. Uncover thy head and fear no harm, for here's good liquor to keep it warm. Chorus. Nectar is a thing assigned by the deity's own mind to cure the heart oppressed with grief, and of good liquors is the chief. Give to the melancholy man a cup or two of it now and then. This physic will soon revive his blood and make him be of a merrier mood. Give to the nymph that's free from scorn no Irish stuff nor Scotch or worn, i.e. no European clothes. Lasses in beaver coats, come away. Ye shall be welcome to us night and day. Chorus. And Eo to Hymen, now the day has come, etc., etc. Drink and be merry. In other words, Morton hinted here of pederasty by mentioning Ganymede, boasted openly of drunkenness, praised the pagan deities Venus and Hymen, criticized the teetotaling melancholy pilgrims whom he derided as moles, and advocated miscegenation with Indian lasses in beaver coats. Or as he himself boasted, quote, he that played Proteus with the help of Priapus put their noses out of joint. Very interesting mix of mythological images there. Proteus, the shapeshifter, and Priapus, the phallic god. And he that played Proteus, that is, Morton saw himself as a Protean figure, with the help of Priapus, put their noses out of joint. In other words, really upset the hell out of the pilgrims. Morton the shapeshifter, with the aid of his erect penis, cocked a snoot at all Protestant morality, another way of putting it. And Protestant morality, in the person of Governor Bradford, answered Morton thus. This is a wonderful quote from Bradford's very well-written and interesting book. Bradford was a good writer, even though he was a creep. After this, he says, they fell to great licentiousness and led a dissolute life, powering out themselves into all profanities. And Morton became lord of misrule and maintained, as it were, a school of atheism. Atheism in the 17th century meant deism, by the way. It meant rejection of organized religion, not of the existence of God. After they had got some goods into their hands and got much by trading with the Indians, they spent it as vainly in quaffing and drinking both wine and strong waters in great excess and, as some reported, 10 pounds worth in a morning. That would have been like an annual salary for an English workman. They also set up a maypole, drinking and dancing about it many days together, inviting the Indian women for their consorts, dancing and frisking together like so many fairies, or furies rather, and worse practices, as if they had anew revived and celebrated the feasts of the Roman goddess Flora, or the beastly practices of the mad Bacchanalians. Again, very perceptive insight into what's going on here. He goes on, Morton, likewise, to show his poetry, composed sundry rhymes and verses, some tending to lasciviousness, and others to the detraction and scandal of some persons, which he affixed to this idol or idle maypole. They changed also the name of their place, and instead of calling it Mount Wollaston, they called it Marymount, as if this joyity would have lasted ever. It's really marvelous. Bradford sent an ad hoc police force to arrest the merrymakers under the command of the famous Miles Standish, or Captain Shrimp, as Morton called him. Apparently the chap was rather small, I don't know. And thus began Morton's career of misery, his jail sentences and escapes, his exile to England, where he published his book, New Canaan, in 1637, important date, three years before the Scottish Presbyterians invaded England and kicked off the Civil War. He returned to America to more trouble and strife. I think he did another jail sentence in Boston. Finally died in 1647 in Maine, where Sir Ferdinando Gorges had established a small colony at Agamenticus. And his grave is still to be seen there. I don't know and have not been able to find out whether Agamenticus had any kind of utopian flavor to it. Nathaniel Hawthorne, who will have been in the minds of some of you for some time now, in his fictionalized version of the events at Marymount, the famous short story, Maypole of Marymount, claimed that, quote, the future... the future complexion of New England was involved in this important quarrel. Should the grisly saints establish their jurisdiction over the gay sinners, then would their spirits darken all the clime and make it a land of clouded visages, of hard toil, of sermon and psalm forever. But should the banner staff of Marymount be fortunate, sunshine would break upon the hills and flowers would beautify the forest, and late posterity do homage to the maypole. Well, we know who won, don't we? If Morton had prevailed, we 20th century marginals might at least have a sort of North American Santeria tradition. A syncretistic religion based on Celtic, classical, and Algonquin paganism, and antinomianism, and bearing a cult which would bear the same relation to high church Anglicanism as voodoo and Santeria bear to Catholicism. An interesting speculation. But, as Hawthorne, of course, knew, Morton lost the battle, and the American future belonged to Puritanism and the work ethic. And yet, the revels of Marymount were not the last festal days of our invisible church of wildness, nor was Morton its only saint. I'm just checking my footnotes to make sure I don't miss anything. These are just book references. Hawthorne plays around with the historical evidence, and he's also completely unaware of the English background. But I still highly recommend that you go back and reread, probably for most of you, Maypole of Marymount, because I think Hawthorne really did, on some level, deeply understand what was going on. And although in the end of the story he pretends that he has sympathy for the Puritan point of view and that after all it was probably a good thing that they won out after all and so forth and so on, this little quote that I just read I think reveals, well, Hawthorne was a very split-minded person, you know. And his attitudes in the funny are in the story are very funny, weird, you know, weirdly dual. But it's that almost schizophrenic aspect is exactly what you need to understand this story, because it represents, it is just a beautiful symbol at the beginning of American North American history, of the schizophrenia that we're all still living in. I mean, this battle, in a sense, this battle actually was never decided. On the face of it, yes, the Puritans won hands down, no question about it. But did they? Anyway, going on to the next saint in my little calendar here, Anne Hutchison, makes a brief appearance in official consensus American history as the heroine or villainess, depending on your point of view, of the antinomian controversy. And I would recommend for anyone who wants to look further into this, the complete documents of the trials of Anne Hutchison have just been published in paperback, a large, expensive academic paperback, but still, you know, something that we could actually consider acquiring. And I haven't read it myself yet, but I imagine it's quite well worth a reading through completely, because these are in fact our records of what Anne really thought, filtered through the pen of the enemy. But still, the Puritans were nothing if not rigidly fair-minded, so I'm sure they didn't distort her words. She's remembered because she was a woman who defied the Puritan patriarchy, probably America's first feminist, if you want to look at it that way, and many historians do. And I think more realistically, she's remembered because she was married to one of the chief patriarchs and thus belonged to the upper classes, the classes who write themselves into history. And because for these reasons her fame has diverted historians' attention from the general context of dissidents in early New England. It seems as if you read some of these history books, as if she were the only rebel, the only antinomian, a lone mutant, a single fly in the ointment of Bostonian orthodoxy. At most, it's admitted that she had a few women disciples, some of whom, like Mary Dyer, were persecuted again 20 years later in the Puritans' anti-Quaker campaign. So as a matter of fact, these few women disciples are well worth tracking and studying, because they represented, obviously, a long, spread-out, continuous, and conscious radical dissidence in Massachusetts. Writers seeking an explanation of the Anne Hutchison mystery tend to set her in a context of social deviance, if they're sociologists, or else treat her as a proto-feminist, if they're feminists, or as a proto-Marxist, if they're Marxists, I don't know. She's one of those curious characters that you can sort of pin anything on you want to, because she didn't, unfortunately, get around to writing anything. So we really are not entirely sure what she thought about things, but aside from what she said at her trial, where she was being bullied by a lot of Puritan men, I think we can reconstruct some of it. Now, valid and useful as these approaches may be, it seems that to me that they miss the context which would have seemed most important to Anne herself, and that is the antinomian movement. What is that? Antinomianism literally means against law. It is generally considered to have begun with the Anabaptists of Münster in the peasant rebellion, so-called, in Germany in 1525. In fact, of course, it has a much earlier history. It doesn't just begin with Protestantism. It must clearly be seen to go back into the Middle Ages and to such heresies as the Brethren of the Free Spirit, the Beghards, and the Beguines. And, I mean, I say this for those of you who are heresy fans like me. For our purposes tonight, we can just assume that antinomianism was considered generally to be an extreme left wing, again, using modern terminology, of the Protestant Reformation. My thesis, as you'll see, is that this is not quite an accurate assessment of what antinomianism really was or is. It's usually seen as a failed and forgotten offshoot of Protestantism, but it may be more accurate to think of it as descended directly from certain medieval heretical sects, such as the Adamites, forgot to mention them, Beghards and Beguines, Franciscan extremists, certain followers of Meister Eckhart. We might mention the Taborites, the Hussites, a whole lot of the Waldensians. Anyway, it's another paper. The main streams of Protestantism, Luther and Calvin, never really englobed this movement. For a while, they all ran parallel courses, and that parallel course was rebellion against Rome. But soon they diverged again. The decisive moment came in 1525 when Luther himself directed the massacre of the antinomian Antibaptist insurgents of Munster. And I've just been reading about this. And the more I read about Luther, the more I dislike the man. A great stylist, a great thinker, all those things, but a bastard, a real son of a bitch. I mean, he not only did he encourage the princes to wipe out the peasants in 1525, when they had done so, and more, I think it was 600,000, I don't know, scads of people bit the dust, you know. Luther said, I did it. He said, let the responsibility be on me. I called for their blood, and I accept it. I mean, he was a brave bastard, but he was also a hideous anti-Semite, and this is an aspect of his thinking that's really suppressed. But I've seen his essay on the Jews, and it could have been written by Hitler. It's disgusting. So, anyway, in other words, he was far from being a real radical, was Luther. Thus, we may think of antinomians as a third way within Christianity. This is my own little thesis here. Neither Catholic nor Protestant. Of course, I say this because, first of all, we can trace it back to medieval heresies that have nothing to do with Protestantism, and also because clearly Protestantism detested antinomianism. Luther and Calvin feared and detested the Anabaptists and all other brands of antinomians. They had no fellow feeling with them at all. As far as they were concerned, they were not part of the same movement at all. And so I don't think we should consider them Protestants either. I think we need to look on the antinomians as something else. Anyway. Of course, many antinomians did consider themselves to be reformers within Protestantism, and I think Anne saw herself in this light at first. But Protestantism always responded to this provocation in the same violent way: expulsion, exile, a hot poker through the tongue, death. In a greater version of the Hutchison affair, the Puritan dictator Cromwell himself was to turn against the extremists who helped bring him to power. He would purge the new model army of levelers and diggers. He would throw ranters into prison and reestablish the censorship, much to Milton's disgust. This invariable reaction against antinomianism must be seen as perfectly natural for Protestant authority. After all, such heresy threatens not only Orthodox ideas, it also challenges the very raison d'etre of organized religion itself. And this, now we're coming to the crunch of the matter. Antinomianism had no center and no dogma. It was made up of a congeries of sects. And we could mention the Family of Love, My One Flesh, Ranters, Seekers, Levelers, Diggers, Libertines, Fifth Monarchy Men, Muggletonians, Behmenites, Hermeticists, a whole array of enough material here for people like me to go on forever and ever and digging into all these obscure little sects. However, for all their whatever they differed about, and really they didn't differ about very much, they were all more or less in agreement on the meaning of certain basic experiences. In fact, the mystical experience itself meant more to them than any dry-bone doctrine or even the Bible. Luther and Calvin made the Bible their thing. This is a major difference here. The Catholic Church makes authority and ritual their thing. Luther and Calvin make the Bible their thing. And the antinomians really are the ones who make the inner light their thing. And this is why they're not only against the established church and against established government even, but it's also why they should be considered mystics and why people like Jacob Boehme had so much influence on these wild and sometimes extremely violent revolutionaries, why a quietist mystic like Boehme became so important for all of these people, at least the ones who read books, which was not all of them by any means. Anyway, from this direct and subjective tasting of grace, the inner light, they derived the certainty of freedom from sin. Just as Jesus freed his followers of some Mosaic laws, and Paul of others, of course, said, love God and do what thou wilt. An attitude which Paul later effectively turned his back on and betrayed. So Christ's second coming would free the faithful from all law, because it would free them from all sin. some chiliastic millenarians, that is to say, people who believed that the world was literally coming to an end. Some of them believed in a literal second coming, but claimed that it had already happened. England and America were full of reborn Christs in those days. While the more mystically inclined antinomians experienced an inward resurrection, a personal light. Now, no mere moral code can impinge on a soul or a body in this state. This was their belief. No action, however paradoxical or seemingly amoral, can stain a realized mind of this sort. The Adamites had symbolized this attainment by going naked for a sign of their Edenic reintegration. The fact paradise now, as you get a slogan from the 60s, would do very nicely for the 17th century in this respect. The family of love later revived this practice of worshiping in the nude later in the 17th century. The more extreme ranters smoked, drank, preached, and blasphemed gloriously in low taverns, and greeted one another by saying, instead of hello, how are you, they would say, rejoice, fellow creature, all is ours. Incidentally, it's interesting to note that the ranters were one of the few Protestant sects who grew their hair long. Having short hair was supposed to show, you know, being a roundhead showed that you were a Puritan. Having long hair was supposed to show that you were a cavalier or a monarchist. But the ranters, who were the most extreme roundhead sect of them all, if you think of them as Protestants, why did they grow their hair long? I think it has something to do with this strange dialectic I was talking about with Morton, between a kind of medievalism that talked about the 100 holidays in a year, let's use that as a symbol of Merry England, right? On the one hand, and a kind of very radical but very rigid and not very fun-loving kind of Puritanism, on the other hand. And the ranters, by growing their hair long, they were not saying that they were monarchists. They were amongst the most violent of the revolutionary sects. What they were saying, I think, no one has ever speculated on this before, but in my opinion, they must have done it in some sense to show that they were not with the Puritans in this rejection of Merry England image, that they wanted both Protestantism and Merry England. All right, that's my hypothesis anyway. And I think you could say that about some of the other sects as well, like the Diggers. Angry Puritans, of course, charged these sects with orgiastic rites. And at least in the case of the ranters, I have a feeling they were right. People who defend heresies are always having to deal with this story, you know, the blowing out of the lamps, right? The idea that this sect, they get together, men and women in the same room, and they blow the lights out, and then everybody, you know, does it. And this is the most common story about heresies in all world literature. It was told about the early Christians. It's told about sects in India that I've come in contact with, and it was told about Puritan sects in England and America. I mean, radical sects in England and America. And in most cases, of course, it isn't true. I mean, you know, if anything, this would probably be a memory of fucking in the furrows in the field to make the plants grow, which might have been an ancient European pagan custom, or indeed a worldwide custom of the Neolithic. And it's a kind of cultural memory of that makes people come up with this story again and again and again and again. In the case of some sects, however, I don't think there's any reason to defend them against stories like this, because they wouldn't have wanted to be defended against it. They would have, if they hadn't been afraid of being immediately arrested and executed, they would have boasted about it. And in fact, there are plenty of anecdotes about ranters preaching with a woman sitting on their knee in a tavern and a ale, you know, and giving a sermon, right? And of these nude worship services and so forth and so on. I don't think we have to whitewash these people and say that, oh, they were just intellectuals, you know. I think they were doing it, whatever it was in their mind. You know, they were certainly trying. This is not to say that Anne Hutchison did any such thing, of course. She was at least as far as I know, she was a very respectable person. Antinomians also tend to agree on politics, which, as I say, is expressed always in religious terms. Not only did the state have no right to control religion, and that was the bone of contention between Puritans and other Protestants, in other words, the Church of England, which was also a Protestant church, thought that the state had the right to control the church. It was the same with Lutheranism. The other Protestants, the Puritans, the Presbyterians, Independents, all your basic official-type Puritans, did not believe that the state had the right to control the church. They thought the church should control itself, but they thought they weren't anarchists. They believed in very strict control, and as we see in Plymouth and Boston, as soon as these people got in control of their own state, it was the most rigid authoritarian state you could possibly imagine. So the argument between the Puritans and other Protestants had to do with the state's role in the church. The antinomians kick them all out, you know, neither state nor church. According to them, the state clearly had no right to legislate morality or taxes or military service or indeed anything at all. Antinomians can be clearly defined as spiritual anarchists, and most adherents considered themselves active revolutionaries. The rich would be overthrown, the poor exalted, the world turned upside down. The millennium, which had already arrived for the sectarians on the psychic level, would be externalized and realized through insurrection on the social level. When Anne Hutchison began to preach in her home to a group of enthusiastic ladies, she scarcely considered herself an antinomian in this sense. She simply believed that her own inner light outshone those of the Boston ministers, even the great John Cotton, who was once her spiritual teacher, but whom she had now left behind with her new revelations. Cotton being one of the most famous Puritan preacher of the period. It was the Puritan fathers who pinned this label on her. It was they who persecuted her, who tried and condemned and banished her from their holy experiment forever. By the time she had passed through these fires, however, she knew what she was. She knew that these fathers were right. She was an antinomian. And she knew that they were wrong as well, because they were cruel, women-hating, dense, narrow bigots. Moreover, she knew her true allies, not the upper class, her own class, of merchants and divines and pious men, but another class made up of the marginalized, the women, the poor, the outsiders. She was not broken by her horrible experiences. Like Roger Williams, who had been condemned the year before her, she went into exile as if into triumph. In fact, she followed Roger Williams to Rhode Island and settled at Aquidneck with some of her associates. There, according to commentators of the period, she openly preached anarchy and broached new heresies every year, as one of these Puritan authors said. Divers of them turned Anabaptist. And would not bear any arms, and denied all magistracy. To deny magistracy meant to deny all government. That is exactly how this phrase would be translated into modern English. Where is that from, anyway? That's from a pamphlet that was published by the Puritans to attack Anne Hutchison. After her husband died, Anne and her group moved to Pelham Bay. And I've been someone. I thought this Pelham Bay is on Long Island, but is that not? It's in the Bronx, right? It is the Bronx, right? Yeah, right. I have to change that. Okay. Is that right? Uh-huh. Oh yeah. Oh, right there. I know where that is. Oh, okay. To escape the abnormally long arm of Massachusetts persecution, she had to make this move. There, tragically, although she and her followers had always condemned violence against Indians, she was murdered in 1643 by tribesmen who mistook her for one of the Dutch. And the Indians were having a horrible time with the Dutch at the moment, and they were basically out on a scalping raid, and they just came across this new settlement and couldn't communicate clearly enough to understand that Anne was not Dutch and that, in fact, she was pro-Indian. It's a horrible irony of American history. The Puritans rejoiced at this deliverance from, quote, a sore affliction, and promptly published their own propagandistic version of her life called A Short Story of the Rise, Reign, and Ruin of the Antinomians, Familists, and Libertines that Inflicted the Churches of New England. This short story, however, was not finished yet. In time, it would lengthen into an epic. Roger Williams, now there's someone we've all heard of, a sincere and moderate liberal. I'm even actually descended from him. Yeah. Which by Massachusetts standards made him into a raving radical. He belonged to a sect called the Seekers. That was his little outfit. They preached that one should wait and search for the inner light, but that meanwhile you should remain tolerant of all creeds, even Jews and Turks, since one never knows from whence illumination may spring. So you can see how shocking that attitude was. In the eyes of the Puritans, such tolerance could only stand condemned as heresy, since they, of course, already possessed the one true light and all its doctrines. They didn't have to wait around for illumination. They had it. Williams never taught anarchy or rebellion. He was certainly not an antinomian. In fact, he turned out instead to be a rather brilliant administrator, and he transformed his exile into the triumphant founding of Rhode Island, a haven of toleration, which extended even to Indian paganism and antinomianism. Many Hutchinsonians fled to the new colony, where they would later involve themselves in Quaker and Radical Baptist activity. The Baptists, believe it or not, were once radicals in the American spectrum. The purest expression of radical Rhode Island thought, however, arose not from any of these groups, but from the left wing of the Seekers, and especially from one remarkable man, William Harris, who may well deserve to be known as the first American individualist anarchist. Now, some people will ask me, why not just say that Anne Hutchinson was the first American anarchist? I think that would probably also be possible, and the only reason why I don't say it is because this report that she denied magistracy was made by her enemies, and I have yet to find any of her friends who actually attributed this idea to her. So I want to be a little cautious. I accept that she probably did become a complete anarchist in the last stage of her life, but we can't say for sure, really, to be fair and honest. However, with William Harris, we can be sure, as you'll hear. Harris had accompanied Williams into exile and shared the hardships of the first few years. But once the colony reached an even keel, the two men discovered that their aims for it were diametrically opposed. Williams's radicalism ended with religious toleration, while Harris's only began there. Williams gradually took on the role of a supreme leader, while Harris moved farther and farther from any form of authority. Roger Williams's first major act of repression was the expulsion of one Samuel Gorton. This is a little parenthesis here. Who, for the usual spiritual reasons, opposed all transgressions of government against the rights guaranteed by English common law. It's really interesting. I'm now reading, in the middle of reading, Christopher Hill's Introduction to 17th Century History, the Century of Revolution. It's fascinating the way everything that happens in England is prefigured by something that happens in America. We're usually thought that, you know, we usually think of colonies as being very much behind the motherland in intellectual fads and movements. What's interesting is that time and again here, we're seeing that the Americans, on a tiny scale, because remember, the population was nothing in those days, on a teeny tiny scale, the Americans are playing out all of these ideological and economic struggles, which are later in the century, 20, 30 years later, going to become the Civil War and the Puritan Revolution. And here again, we have Samuel Gorton talking about the rights of common law, English, the rights, the old Anglo-Saxon law. And this is a slogan that was later used in the 1640s by the parliamentarians to oppose King Charles. They said the divine right of kings, whoever heard of that? You know, that's a new idea. And if it's new, it must be bad. The old idea is, you know, Parliament, Magna Carta, the freeborn Englishmen, et cetera, et cetera. And this, so this was the way they justified their ideology by reference to the past. And here we find it being done in in the 1630s anyway. Just as that idea begins to take off in England, already we have extreme radical intellectuals in America who have already thought through the whole process. Very interesting. In 1642, which in other words, right in the middle of the English Civil War, Gorton broke off and founded his own colony in Shawomet, Rhode Island, on pro-Indian and extreme libertarian lines. Later on, after he rejoined Rhode Island 5 years later, in other words, more or less after the English Revolution, when the moment had passed, you know, and it was clear that the English Revolution had been betrayed, he remained a radical and managed to have imprisonment for debt ended and wrote the first law abolishing slavery in America, which sadly was rescinded again a few years later. But Gorton, therefore, belongs the honor of being the first American abolitionist. Roger Williams's drift to the right, as we could call it, continued with the establishment of compulsory military service in 1655. The Hutchinsonian Baptists and Quakers protested and even attempted open rebellion. Roger Williams reacted with new laws against immorality and loose living and with anti-Baptist persecutions. In 1656, and it's always interesting to compare these dates with what's going on in England, that would be 55 was the Restoration, wasn't it? I'm not sure. What is the year? What is the Restoration? 1660? Anyway, so this is like the revolution is in deep trouble by this time in the homeland. In 1656, William Harris at last launched his revolt against these Cromwellian tactics of Roger Williams by publishing a book which has been lost, a story that we hear very often about those who lose the battles. Their books get lost with them. But we know something about Harris's book, because Williams responded to it with legal action, and we have some trial, legal documents to learn a little bit from. According to Roger Williams, Harris had lived, quote, in the woods like Nebuchadnezzar, not fit for the society of men in town. This hermit was harsh and naughty in body, resentful in temper, pugnacious, keen in perception, and in voice rasping and acerbic. Probably, by all accounts, a fair picture of Harris. Not an easy guy to get along with in a lot of ways. Since his book is lost, we cannot say for sure that Harris called himself an anarchist. In fact, I would rather suspect that he didn't. I don't think that this word came into general usage until much later. But by all accounts, that is exactly what he was. His own term for his ideas was generalism, a term that nobody picked up. It was never used again in this sense. According to the biographer of Roger Williams, in Harris's book on anarchy, the biographer calls it a book on anarchy, so I'm not the first person to notice this tendency in Harris's thought. In his book on anarchy, he upheld liberty with a vengeance. A transcendental anarchist, he expected liberty to descend somehow upon the individual who was to realize himself fully by the overthrow and destruction of all law and order in society. As a social being, the individual was to sail safely and unmolested over the uncertain sea of life, vexed by winds and waves and strewn with islands, shoals, and rocks, unaided by civil chart or social compass. The relations that you can feel what this writer thinks of such ideas. The relations that Mr. Williams held exist between the conscience and God, and with which no human law may interfere, were extended by Harris to include all relations of man to man, citizen to state, and thereby to dissolve all government, establish the sovereignty of the individual, and end all laws. Civil restraint to conscience, thought, or action of man is an evil. The individual would be good if civil restraint were removed. Harris advocated unrestrained individualism without law or government, anarchy. This doctrine caused a great stir in the colony. uneasy spirits chafing at the new restraints of the Roger Williams's policy saw the dawn of a new day. No lords, no masters became their war cry. The improvident, the ambitious, and the land poor, the scum in other words, saw in Harris an angel of light and hope. Dissent and discontent flocked to his banner. As I say, this is from a biography of Roger Williams. And the biographer is obviously much more in sympathy with Roger Williams than with Harris. And therefore, once again, it's although he's quite quick to call Harris an anarchist, and I think he's right, perhaps we should be cautious. I don't know. I myself am proposing him now instead of the 19th century figures who are usually given the credit with being the first American anarchist. And that's my argument. You can take it or leave it. Harris wound up his polemic by describing his enemies as, and this is a quote from the book that appeared in the trial records, describing his enemies as thieves, robbers, hypocrites, satyrs, owls, courts of owls, dragons, devils, soldiers, the worst of all, and legions of devils. Soldiers were anathema to this kind of thinking, and they're very anti-militaristic. In defending himself against the Roger Williams packed court, he exclaimed, quote, that for all that, he had nothing to lose but an old coat for the hangman. History has forgotten Harris, of course, because Harris lost. And Roger Williams is remembered because he won. Harris was plagued by bad luck all his life. Once he was even captured by Algerian corsairs and sold as a slave. In his latter days, his lifelong quarrel with Roger Williams degenerated into legal squabbles over land titles, which is where we learn that he had a very cranky side to his personality, because he went on litigating until he died. Nevertheless, this is no reason to impugn his sincerity, as I've seen some historians do, or to demote him to the rank of a mere eccentric. Individualist anarchism is usually said to have appeared in America only in the mid-19th century with Josiah Warren, Lysander Spooner, that lot. But Harris had expounded all the central ideas of individual sovereignty in the mid-17th century on the basis of radical antinomian speculation. Hutchison died before she could fully develop all these ideas, so the title of first American anarchist, I think, seems to belong to Harris. Hats off, ladies and gentlemen, and 2 minutes of silence, or anyway, 20 seconds of silence for the first American anarchist. The big difference between Quakerism and other antinomian sects lay in the Quaker adoption of pacifism and non-resistance as opposed to the open revolutionism of the levelers or ranters. Again, if we want to study this in England in the 1650s, we can actually see the Quakers turning from a ranter-like revolutionary sect into a quietistic Jakob Boehme type of sect. And we can, I've mentioned? Yes, I'll get to him, James Naylor. In most respects, the early Quakers were scarcely distinguishable from other extremists. When the Quaker prophet James Naylor rode into Bristol, England, on an ass in 1655, people got the reference right away. Cromwell responded to this messianic display with violent persecution. Naylor's tongue was bored. Cromwell took it all quite seriously and launched a general persecution of the mystical left. The Quakers reacted by distancing themselves from politics and preaching against ranterism. And then, of course, when the Restoration came along, they went even farther in that direction. And this relatively conservative policy undoubtedly preserved Quakerism as an institution in the long run. I mean, the Quakers are still with us. The ranters, no. They're gone. They never got organized. The Quakers organized, they became an institution, and they became nonviolent, which is to say, non-threatening to the state. In fact, Quakerism became respectable enough to be granted its own American utopia in Pennsylvania. The ranters also came to the New World, but as refugees or transported criminals rather than as decent, if nonconformist, colonists. We learn, for example, that a ranter named Perrot, P-E-R-R-O-T, the bearded ranter who was famous for refusing to doff his hat to the Almighty, ended up in Barbados, as did Joseph Salmon. Salmon, a much more interesting character who wrote quite a lot, and his works can be found in various books that are in print today even. A dropout from the New Model Army, which wasn't radical enough for him, began as a seeker but gradually moved more and more towards extreme positions throughout the mid-1600s. One authority reported his, quote, wicked swearing and uncleanness, which he justified, and others of his way, that it was God which did swear, that is, blaspheme, in them, and that it was their liberty to keep company with women for their lust. As Salmon himself put it, that was a remark made by an enemy, as Salmon himself put it, the Lord grant we may know the worth of hell, that we may forever scorn heaven. For my own part, I am ascended far above all heavens, yet I fill all things and laugh in my sleeve to think what's coming. Salmon was arrested in 1649 and, quote, was able to attract a considerable audience by preaching through the gates of prison of his prison on Sundays. After his release, he seems to have emigrated voluntarily to the Barbados, although he might have been transported. As one author says, as actually my friend Peter Limebaugh says, in a Zen-like search for nothing, or else to cause trouble by organizing separatist meetings, as another historian mentions. Another quote from Salmon talking about Zen-like nothing, if you think that's something in Limebaugh's head, listen to this quote. He says, I appeared to myself as one confounded into the abyss of eternity, non-entitized into the being of beings. It's about as close to Zen as we can get in the 17th century. Perrot and Salmon were intellectuals, that even though they were plebeians, they were intellectuals, they were literate, in other words, and their names at least are remembered. But rank and file ranters, and there were many illiterate ranters from the scum level, also emigrated or were deported. A Quaker lady found herself troubled by ranters at a general meeting in Oyster Bay and another at Rhode Island as late as 1680, according to a diary, I think, that she had kept. It seems logical to assume that when Boston Puritans, for example, accused people of being ranters, familists, libertines, etc., they were not necessarily just mudslinging. Some of their victims really did belong to these sects and doubtless ended up in Massachusetts as deported rogues, especially after the mid-1650s, and then I would imagine again after the Restoration. Similar suppositions, and by the way, the article by Christopher Hill that I mentioned earlier about radical pirates absolutely bears out my suppositions on this point. He also agrees that many of the pirates must have been radical sectarians. Similar suppositions may be made, in fact, he proves it in a number of cases. Similar suppositions may be made about Rhode Island and Pennsylvania, and even the Carolinas were once called the refuge of the sectaries or sectarians in 1683, that phrase comes from. Georgia may also have served this function. Georgia, of course, began as a prison colony and in the 1680s, and there were still a lot of these sectarians, especially the Fifth Monarchy men, were still very active in the 1680s. Would it then appear unreasonable to suspect the influence of these sectarians in various colonial-era uprisings, such as Bacon's Rebellion or the Regulator Movement? Rogue Quakers, whatever they may have been, were implicated in the latter event, the Regulator Movement of the Carolinas. And something which I didn't mention in the paper, there were people involved in the Regulator Movement in the 1680s, whose names appeared, who were very young then, and they were in the Regulator Movement. There's at least one guy is known absolutely for sure. Later appeared as a soldier in the Revolutionary War, fighting, of course, for the Revolution. And then was last heard of as an old man fighting in Shay's Rebellion after 1790. Exactly how this is possible, this guy must have been a centenarian at this point. Or maybe it was his son. I mean, we can never be entirely sure, but that would make it a family tradition. In other words, they began with the Regulator Movement, which was a failed uprising against British rule, went on through the Revolution, which was a success, and then immediately turned against the new government and joined yet another rebellion, Shay's Rebellion. So there was obviously Morton and Cohn and Thompson and British historians like to talk about a proletarian or working class tradition. I think this we can definitely see the laying of this tradition here, and we can see it in the radical Protestant sect. As for the Quakers of Pennsylvania, although they lacked some of the flair for self-martyrdom exhibited earlier in both Old and New England, nevertheless, they took the idea of the holy experiment quite seriously. In fact, a good deal more seriously than William Penn himself. As a wealthy Protestant grandee, Penn envisioned Pennsylvania as his own feudal fiefdom, which he would never even have to visit, complete with quit rents and monopolies. True, he preached religious toleration and peace with the Indians, but compared to Roger Williams, he was a right-wing reactionary. And we've already learned that Roger Williams, compared to the real left-wing, could be considered a reactionary. So I think you can see Penn is a rather unsympathetic character. Luckily for the holy experimenters, however, he was an absentee landlord, and they simply decided to ignore him. Spurred on first by the Lloyd family, Thomas and David, and later Murray Rothbard's analysis, who's written an interesting little article on this, Philadelphia enjoyed 4 years of total de facto anarchy from 1684 to 1688, and thereafter struggled to retain it till at least 1696. At that point, the first tax bill was finally passed, and of course denounced by the radicals as an attack on, quote, our ancient rights, liberties, and freedom. Ancient as of like 10 years ago, but... That was the way, you have to read the language of the time. Whenever you hear somebody talking about ancient rights and liberties, it may sound like the Ku Klux Klan to us now, you know. But in those days, contextualize it, that was a radical slogan. Ancient rights was a radical slogan. As one of Penn's unsuccessful agents had complained in horror, these Quakers, quote, have not the principles of government amongst them, nor will they be informed. Unquote. And when the Conservative Party condemned George Keith, who preached that friends should not engage in government any more than in war, they quite properly pointed out that his pamphlets showed, quote, a tendency to sedition and disturbance of the peace, as also to the subversion of the present government. Keithian doctrines are said to have interested Ben Franklin and Thomas Paine. Deism. I mentioned before that atheism is usually, again, in reading the language of the 17th century, atheism is usually a code term used by its enemies to describe deism, which was a belief in God as a kind of, and the usual explanation is that you believe in God, but you think that he's kind of left the universe to get along on its own, and it's really up to us, you know. That we worship God, of course, as the creator, so forth and so on, but we don't belong to a church. Because the true divine order is to be in liberty, to be free of institutions. This was the original deistic idea. This was Thomas Paine's brand of deism, and indeed most of the even the most extreme radicals of the. I have yet to find anybody in the 17th century who openly admitted that he didn't believe in or she didn't believe in God. I don't really think anybody was hiding anything. Newton, maybe, but even, you know, as we know, even Newton practiced alchemy in secret. So I think it's probably fair to believe that even Bacon and Newton literally, truly did believe in God. They weren't being hypocrites about that. True atheism, as we now understand it, is a 19th century invention, in my opinion, maybe 18th. Might come in with the libertines of the extreme libertine branch of the French Enlightenment. That would be my guess. They would have probably been the first people to actually come out and say they didn't believe in any God at all. So deism, which is usually depicted as a stage on the way towards cool agnostic rationality, also, however, had a hot and mystical side to it in the 17th century. After all, it was but a short step from the antinomian God of inner light to the deist God of the inner light of reason, a word which then meant something more like mind than mere rationality. Reason did not mean rationalism or rationality. It meant reason and hence mind or the principle of, you might almost say, spirit. And in fact, the ranters, who sometimes spoke of God as reason, as did the diggers, Winstanley and the diggers,
were also accused of atheism. So we can see what the 17th and 18th century meant by atheism. Deists were also atheists in this sense. And like the extremist sects, they had their mystics and visionaries. Their mysticism, however, tended away from the pole of contemplation toward that of action. They were not followers of Burma. You know, they were not mystics in that sense. As free thinkers and as heirs to much libertarian Protestant thought, their imaginations worked in utopian and revolutionary ways. Nor can all deists be described as middle-class intellectuals, which is something I've seen in many history books. But Paine was a working-class deist and very nearly an anarchist. And so were many soldiers who later came to swell the ranks of the Revolutionary Army in 1776. One brand of mystical deism crystallized as Freemasonry, an occult order with radical revolutionary ideas and aims. The first American Masons appeared a few years before the official establishment of the London Grand Lodge in 1715, I think. I think I might have this date wrong by a year. As a matter of fact, I recently found out that the first Freemasons appeared in America considerably before that. I've just read a book called The Origins of Freemasonry, which pushes the whole thing back to about 1590, documented, and points out that the first known Masons landed in America in the 1680s. By 1730, Benjamin Franklin provided the first reference to organized lodges in the New World. The Masons themselves, of course, claim that Raleigh and Dee and that whole crowd were Masons, and that Virginia itself was a Masonic experiment. Well, who knows? In their recent and surprisingly unsensationalistic book on Masonry, The Temple and the Lodge, Bajant and Lee, these are the characters who wrote Holy Blood, Holy Cow, I mean Holy Grail. Their new book is much more laid back. They document the fascinating double nature of New World Masonry. On the one hand, more bourgeois colonists tended to belong to lodges chartered by the official London Grand Lodge, which was basically sort of Whiggish, deistic, middle-class, loyalist, but sort of loyal oppositionist politically. On the other hand, many soldiers of lower-class origin joined the so-called military lodges, which were not chartered by London, but by the Grand Lodge of Ireland. These Irish charters, which were considered spurious by London, gave rise to a kind of underground masonry, which went on for a good time in America and may still be going on for all I know. In later times, they came to be known as the Scald Miserable Masons. I don't know what that means. S-C-A-L-D, Scald, like scalded. I don't know why. Which was never successfully reintegrated into mainstream masonry. Now, George Washington and his cronies, of course, belonged to the official branch. But clearly, both branches found common cause in the vision of American independence. As everyone knows, Washington won this one. Somewhat less clearly remembered, however, is his private inauguration ritual in full Masonic regalia. How many of you have heard of that? Yes, well, there's a painting of it. You can see it in Washington, D.C., and if you know what you're looking at, there's the Masonic apron, the whole thing. Bajant and Lee make a very convincing argument for the Constitution, skipping ahead in history here a little bit, convincing argument for the Constitution as a Masonic manifesto and America as a Masonic Republic. It would be interesting, however, to know more about the politics of the Irish or Scald Masons. Were they among the extreme Democrats who felt betrayed by the oligarchic counter-revolution of 1789? Were they, in fact, involved in the Shays Rebellion and the Whiskey Rebellion? Were they among the revolutionary veterans, yes, I said that, who fought against Washington and his cronies in Shays Rebellion and a handful of lesser uprisings in the 1790s? Perhaps this is a futile inquiry, as so many Masonic inquiries are. But in any case, it seems clear that Masonry cannot be excluded from the role of revolutionary mystical sects of colonial America. The deists, like all other antinomians, and I think we could include them somehow, or as at least related to antinomianism, were attracted by the image of the wild man and of the wild man as noble savage. It's no accident that the conspirators in both the Boston and the New Jersey Tea Parties dressed up as Indians, nor that the rebel backwoods farmers in the Berkshires declared their region declared that their region had reverted to the state of nature in 1774, I believe. By this time, the state of nature had come to mean something very specific. It meant without government. And that when the Berkshire farmers said that they had, their region had reverted to the state of nature, they meant they had they were the first ideologically to completely throw off the yoke of English government. But interestingly enough, they didn't seem to be in any hurry to replace it with anything. For both revolutionary intellectuals and the revolutionary mob felt a certain kinship with Native American spirituality. The Five Nations Treaty of Confederation exercised powerful influence on the Articles of Confederation, which is a truly radical democratic document, by the way, and even on the Declaration of Independence. This unlikely link between Native shamanism and deism emerges with poignant clarity in the mysterious case of one Christian Prieber of Georgia, P-R-I-B-E-R. Christian Prieber, probably from Germany, arrived in the New World in the 1730s as an accomplished philosophe, conversant in English, Dutch, by which I presume they meant German, French, and Latin. Although I suppose he could have been Dutch, too, for that matter. No, we don't really know. With one all-consuming obsession, the founding of a utopian socialist libertarian community amongst the natives of South Carolina and Georgia. At his trial in 1743, which coincidentally was the same year American colonists first rioted against impressment, marked by some historians as the beginning of the revolutionary movement, it was said that Prieber had schemed to, quote, set up a town at the foot of the mountains among the Cherokees, which was to be a city of refuge for all criminals, debtors, and slaves, who would fly thither from justice or their masters. Moreover, there was a book found upon him of his own writing, ready for the press, which he owns and glories in. It demonstrates the manner in which the fugitives are to be subsisted, and lays down the rules of government by which the town is to be governed by, to which he gives the title of Paradise. He enumerates many whimsical privileges and natural rights, as he calls them, which his citizens are to be entitled to, particularly dissolving marriages and allowing community of women, and all kinds of licentiousness. The book is drawn up very methodically and full of learned quotations. It is extremely wicked, yet has several flights full of invention, and 'tis a pity so much wit is applied to so bad purposes. It's from the local newspaper. During the previous years, Prieber had sold all of his possessions and disappeared into Cherokee country, learned the language, and wrote the first dictionary of it, which was later lost, of course, along with his book, and went native to such an extent that, as one historian said, he ate, drank, slept, danced, dressed, and painted himself with the Indians, such that whites could no longer distinguish him from the natives. According to one of his enemies, quote, he proposed to them a new system or plan of government, that all things should be in common amongst them, that even their wives should be so, and the children should be looked upon as the children of the public and taken care of as such and not by their natural parents, and that they should admit into their society Creeks and Catawbas, French and English, all colors and complexions, in short, all who were of these principles, which were truly such as had no principles at all. Prieber was no authoritarian utopian in the Plato Moore tradition. He stressed liberty along with community of property, and in his kingdom of paradise, the only law was to be the law of nature. Moreover, as his biographer notes, the liberty which was allowed to men should be shared equally by women, in sign of which no marriages should be contracted. The children of the temporary unions were to be reared by the state and instructed in everything which they were capable of learning. In other words, let me make an important distinction here. His enemies accused him of wanting to have women in common, which was one of the things that heretics always get accused of. It seems much more likely that what he was talking about was the abolition of marriage and the adoption of the children by the state or by the community, which of course would not constitute. See, community of women, feminists, as feminist, many feminists have noted, is not that great for women. You know, it's radical, but only from the man's point of view. If, however, we talk not only about the abolition of marriage, but the adoption of children by the community, then women's objections to the abolition of marriage have effectively been removed. And in general, this is not a step that was taken in feminist thinking until the late 18th, early 19th century. So Priebe seems to have been a real pioneer in this respect, if I'm interpreting the texts correctly. The children of the temporary unions were to be reared by the state and instructed in everything which they were capable of learning. Right. Apparently, Priebe won the hearts of the Cherokee, though he may have ended by learning more from them than they from him. In any case, they protested angrily, the Cherokee, that is, protested angrily when the colonial authorities, under the famous Governor Oglethorpe of Georgia, arrested and imprisoned him. Priebe languished in jail a few years, then died. His books vanished. He was another failure, another bit of lost American history, condemned to insignificance by his victorious enemies. In fact, the major article about him is called, Oh, I've got my pages all out of order here. Anyway, it's called something like A Lost Utopia of the Georgia Frontier. As lost and as failed as you can get. Or was he such a failure? The Cherokee later became famous, after all, for developing the first Native American system of writing. Could that have had anything to do with Priebe's dictionary? They were also known for their hospitality toward maroons or runaway slaves, and white indentured servants. Certain sub-tribes of the Cherokees, such as the Lumbee, who are still very much around, are classified as triracial. Perhaps some of them are actually descended from Priebe, that obscure savant and gentleman who played out again the story of Roanoke, but this time in full consciousness of its utopian implications. Priebe came to America in order to go to Croatan, to seek redemption in wildness and wilderness. Like Morton of Merrymount, like Anne Hutchison and the radicals of Rogue Island, as it was commonly known at the time, his spirituality was bound up with that of the vast wilderness and its natives. A strain of American spirituality summed up, as it were, by Thoreau, muttering on his deathbed, forests, Indians, famous last words of Thoreau. But Priebe also encompassed the European radical tradition, which in turn was rooted in libertarian heresy and antinomianism. In fact, he synthesizes all the main currents of the tradition this essay has investigated, and we may well nominate him for one of our saints. The American Revolution is generally interpreted as a bourgeois liberal movement, but recently some radical American historians, and I mentioned them at the beginning of this lecture, have begun to pay closer attention to the role of the mob, to proletarian and extremist elements in the struggle, and to their antecedents and influences. Just as official Puritan Protestantism has been considered in some ways a foreshadowing of official American republicanism, so one may argue that non-official radical Protestantism and its attendant Indianism served as the matrix for extreme revolutionary tendencies within the general dissidents and the anti-imperialist movement. The nameless antinomians of low estate, who followed Anne Hutchison into exile, were the spiritual ancestors of the rioters, farmers, sailors, soldiers, freed slaves, Irish laborers and debtors, who pushed leaders like Sam Adams and Thomas Paine ever farther to the left. Spiritual anarchy is America's oldest heritage and its most secret and submerged tradition. And although we've limited ourselves here to the colonial period, we cannot end without asserting that our invisible church outlasted not only the Revolution, but even the Federalist counter-revolution. And in the 1790s, we have one Nathan Barlow, the New England mystic who led the squatters of Kennebec County in Maine against the sheriffs and land agents of the out-of-state proprietors, in small bands of armed white Indians, so-called. He wrote, "Every man to his right and privileges and liberty, the same, not as the ancient Anglo-Saxons, but the same as our Indian nation enjoys. They burned barns, rescued prisoners, upset courts, and destroyed writs into atoms." says the historian. And here, trembling on the verge of the 19th century, we'll close our story, confident that the reader will be able to trace the trajectory of our tradition into this more modern age, and indeed even into the 20th century and our own days. Caliban's Masque is not yet played out, nor can spiritual anarchy be consigned to the catalog of dead things. Thank you. JP, do we have time for a little questioning?
A little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, last week there was a woman here who went on and on for a while about William Shakespeare and Francis Bacon.
Yes, I had her on my radio show.
Yeah,
right.
That's why I brought it up, because you brought up William Shakespeare at the beginning of your lecture. And according to her, that William Shakespeare was just this illiterate loudmouth.
Yeah, yeah. And Bacon was founded Freemasonry, too.
Yeah,
right.
Freemasonry.
Right. She said.
And then the one with Dr. D and Raleigh and everything. So, I mean, you know.
No, Bacon didn't get along with that crowd, you know. And I have some suspicions about that lady's theory.
Uh-huh.
And, Bacon was very much the, by comparison, very much the rationalist. And really one of the founders of what later became known as the mechanistic or mechanical philosophy. Whereas Dee and Raleigh and all those people were very much on the side of what was known in those days as natural philosophy, which was still very much influenced by Renaissance Neoplatonism, Hermeticism, high magic, and all alchemy, astrology, and all that kind of aspect of natural magic / natural philosophy. So, no, Bacon doesn't figure in my story. Bacon, I think, is... I don't know. I've always very much disliked Bacon myself.
Yeah, since last week I've heard a lot of bad things. So William Shakespeare was literate. He might have written the plays. What?
If Shakespeare didn't write the plays, it was some other guy called Shakespeare. So, you know. Yeah. Yeah.
Given that there was no monarchy of the language at this time, or let's say that religious thought and moral thought was used as a way of transforming social interaction, how do you think this influenced the 18th century ideas, the Lockean, Locke of...
You want a little thesis of the influence of the 17th century on the 18th century?
Well, more specific, the notion of natural law.
Yeah.
The notion of the contractual theory of government, of natural rights, human to human beings, equal, coming together.
Yeah. Well, of course, some of it had to do with the Protestant covenant theory, theology, the covenant between man and God. That, in other words, it was a way of seeing God not so much in the light of a kind of divine right of kings, divine right of God way of looking at things, but more as a partnership, you know, or at least a relationship, mutually, you know, with flow back and forth. It was an up and down, but still, you know, back and forth. Of course, there are some scholars who are working on precisely this thing. Margaret Jacob is a scholar who's exploring the borderland between the 17th and the 18th century through Freemasons and pamphleteers and the kind of lower intelligentsia, the people that we don't really remember, the ones who did the dog work for the Baconians and the Newtonians and the, you know, the other big heroes that we remember who fought out ideology on the level of pure ideology. What Jacobs is doing that's so nice is she's getting down into the shenanigans of spies and agents and pamphleteers and masons and discovering how these great ideas of the Bacon or the Newton or the Descartes played themselves out in society. You know, the betrayal and then the destruction of the Puritan Revolution, so-called Puritan Revolution, which is not a phrase that historians really want to use anymore, in England, really put the kibosh on radical development in England for a long time. And it wasn't until a century later and in America that it could emerge again. But that there was such an influence, of course. I mean, in America, the name of Cromwell, which school children were taught to hate after the Restoration continually pops up throughout American literature, especially American popular literature. I say this not on my own cognizance, but because some historian noticed it, constantly crops up in popular literature as a hero. Cromwell is always remembered on the level of popular literature and oral transmission. And of course, you know, I have a lot of problems with Cromwell myself, especially being of Irish ancestry. But, you know, I'm just pointing out that the betrayal of the revolution, which took place at the same time, made it into a secret tradition, made it into a hidden tradition that had its own power. And I think, you know, it could be traced not only in America, not only into the French Revolution, but on into Chartism and, you know, the rise of the early labor unions in England and the whole thing, you know. So it's a continual story, it's a continuous story. And that's what this new school of historians that I've talked about in England and America have made so nicely clear at last, that the breaks and the gaps and the inconsistencies that the official history tells us about are not there. They've just been papered over by official history. And now that we're tearing off that official wallpaper and getting down to the cracks and the fissures, and we see that, in fact, I'm stretching this metaphor a little too far, but that they're filled with the plaster of radical tradition, you know, of a radical tradition that begins, if you want to, it has no beginning, it's constant, it's part of human nature, but begins in the sense of modern history with, let's say, in the 13th century with the Brethren of the Free Spirit, you know, who were the first to propose what became the religious ideology of rebellion. So is that what you meant? Is that the kind of answer you were looking for?
I've always had this feeling, it's nothing more than intuition, moral force, let us be philosophical about it, call it moral imperative, is co-opted politically by the actual development of the spirit.
Oh, yeah.
That is a very conscious displacement
yes.
of this force.
I see what you mean, yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. There's no question about it, especially once you can see this in the history of Freemasonry again. The Freemasonry, which begins as a radical revolutionary sect, if you want to look at it that way, when they win and they get into power, they've got an ideology of republicanism and of freedom and all this kind of thing, but what does it become? You know, it becomes the American Constitution, one of the most reactionary documents in the history of human thought. Right?
Coming from the Moorish Orthodox Church?
Well, do you mean Islam? In this, do you mean from an Islamic point of view? Well, as a matter of fact, as a matter of fact, I think there was an Islamic presence in America from the beginning. In the Moriscos, the supposed converts who remained in Spain and did not leave in 1492. Significant date, by the way. Do you have documentation on that?
Not on me. I just heard this that turned into electricity.
Well, there were of course constant memories amongst black people who had been enslaved who were Muslims. So we have, for example, some of these triracial groups that I was discussing, for example, preserve a very clear folk memory of Islamic influences that, in my opinion, must go back quite early and possibly even into colonial times. And I would bet you anything there were Muslims on Columbus's ship. It's just that they were Moriscos. In other words, they were converts. But you know how serious their conversion was. Why were they on the ship? Where did they hope to get to? You know what was going on. So. I don't know about influence, but presence, absolutely. There's an Islamic presence in America from 1492 on, that's my guess. Yeah?
Are you familiar at all with any of the Russian religious dissident groups and their descendants in Western Canada?
Like the Duchobors, you mean? Yeah.
And it's much more later
stuff. Oh, yeah. They didn't come over till the late 19th century. Tolstoy was responsible for their coming to America. The Duchobors, yeah, they're great. You can read about them in Eamon Hennessy, his book about spiritual anarchists, which is a lovely book, by the way. but mostly not in this period, so I didn't have a chance to make any use of it. But he's got a great chapter on the Doukhobors. They used to take their clothes off and burn their own houses down. That was, the Canadians could not understand this at all. What? Yes, yeah, they took their, then they would get busted, and then they would do it in the courtroom. Yeah, my old friend Harry Smith, the surrealist filmmaker who died a couple of months ago, grew up not far from the Doukhobors. And when I asked him about them, he said, "Oh, yes, the Doukhobors. My mother was always afraid of them." So, yeah.
Did I understand you to say that the Roanoke colony was all male?
Did who say?
Did you say that there was all men?
At some point, the original settlement were all men. That's right. Yeah.
Well, that's the reason.
Yeah. Oh, lasses in beaver coats. Come away, come away.
On the subject of popular literature, do you have any comments on the roots of the Peter Pan story where the wild man, the green man, is juxtaposed with Pirate City with her opponent?
Are you the one who wrote that letter to the New York Press?
No.
Somebody wrote a letter saying something about my theory of the green man. My theory of the green man. I don't know. I don't remember talking in public about it. Someone must have read my mind. Uh-huh. So just quickly rephrase your question.
Peter Pan, the pirate, and the green man are enemies. I think Silver's latest version where a pirate is a term of opprobrium insult. How do you...
Well, first of all, because J.M. Barrie was a middle class, and in fact, let's not put it too fine a face on, he was a bourgeois, English snob, who and a moralist, but essentially the fact that you've got the two characters in the same story means more than that they're opposed to each other. In the, you should pardon the expression, The Green Man, where you can see the famous face of the Green Man, it's not an obscure story in England. You know, it's standard folklore. So, yeah.
Well, if you're going to start saying Barry was of the upper middle class, then he's making his own class nobility. Because he identifies Captain Hook quite explicitly as a product of the public school system.
Yeah, well, of course,
there's all sorts of snide humor about
absolutely
worrying whether he's good form or not.
That's right. Well, Barry was a raving schizophrenic, what can I tell you? I mean, have you read the biography of the Lost Boys, the book that came out about Barry some years ago, a couple of years ago, a few years ago? Guy was, he was a wacko. Any more questions? Yeah.
Something about the pirates who landed at this time, I understand it's quite a bit of maybe obscure influence in that these people came ashore and became involved in the colonial situation and they had money and organization.
Absolutely, absolutely. I some years ago gave a lecture on pirate utopias, which I unfortunately never wrote up. But I came up with an immense amount, to my mind, an overwhelming proof of the pirates as proto-revolutionary types, not just as the scum of the sea, not just as proto-capitalists, but for example, just to give you one example, a couple of examples. When the private, you know what a privateer is as opposed to a pirate? A privateer is someone who has a license to steal from a government.
A pirate with connections.
A pirate with connections. The privateers, they also signed articles. When you went on a privateering cruise, just like the pirates, they would sign a document called the Articles for the cruise. I look on these as virtually, in the case of the pirates, constitutions, since their ships were powers unto themselves. The articles for them were constitutions. For the privateers, however, they were just commercial documents. And the captain of the average privateering expedition would get 40 shares to the crew member's single share. Whereas among the pirates, the captain almost never made as much as 2 shares. It was usually 1 3/4, as opposed to the single share of the crew member. The quartermaster and other skilled members of the crew would often make the same number of shares as the captains. The captains were frequently elected, and we have many examples of them being deposed. One of the historians came up with a particularly badly run pirate ship that had something like 6 captains in 3 months.
very similar to a modern anarchist group, you know. And, of course, if you believe Daniel Defoe, who himself was a radical Whig and had reasons to stretch the evidence, but if you believe Daniel Defoe, a lot of the pirates were plain out-and-out social radicals who either went to sea to escape power or because they wanted to realize themselves in that way. So you have, for example, the famous Captain Mission, who's written about in Defoe. Many historians now deny that this chap ever existed. I'm agnostic on the subject, but the very fact that Defoe could write in 1724, which is when the General History of the Pirates came out, about a Captain Mission who started an anarchist utopia in Madagascar, and not a single contemporary writer, critic, or reviewer said that they didn't believe the story. In other words, it was very credible at the time that such a character could have existed. So whether he existed or not, it's significant that Defoe, whether he made him up or recorded the story, it's still significant. And the significance is that in the 1720s, which was the end of the golden age of piracy, so to speak, there were plenty of people around who were quite willing to believe in the pirate as a social rebel. Why? I think because pirates were social rebels, or at least there were social rebels amongst them. And the proof is in, if you want documentary proof, we've got the articles of the ships that show exactly how democratic and egalitarian they were. Now, when they had their shore settlements, as opposed to the ships, a lot of cases there, they had no founding document at all. So you could call that, in effect, real anarchy. And not only in Madagascar, but in Nassau, Bahamas, which was probably the last and most famous of these communities, which were, I call them the pirate utopias. And I think that these were, you know, they weren't meant to be permanent settlements necessarily, but they were the land settlements of these proto-social rebel pirates, and therefore they were organized in an anarchist, a proto-anarchist way, if we don't want to use the word anarchist in this period. And if you want proof, read Defoe. It's there. You know, you can definitely find it in Defoe. Even in Esquemelin, who wrote about the buccaneers, absolutely talks about their egalitarianism, about their hatred of all authority, how they were dropouts from the Navy and the Merchant Marine, who were escaping the, you know, horrible conditions in the British Navy of the period, where you could be flogged for stealing a line, you know, flogged to death for, et cetera, et cetera. Impressed, a lot of them were impressed into the service in the first place. And they, you know, they got off on the island of Hispaniola, and they found that they could live there. And they had a community of freedom, probably the first real community of freedom in the New World. I think so. I think that no one says they're mythical. That was a Captain Calico Jack Rackham. And yeah, that's a great story. It's a great story. They're the greatest woman pirate of all time, if you're interested. In China, I forget her name, but she's sort of the original dragon lady. In the 18th century, she had a fleet of over 2,000 war junks. And the entire population, entire coastal population of China had to move 10 kilometers inland. I swear. And the only way the Chinese government, of course, very decadent Manchu government of the period, could deal with this was to offer her a position in the government. And she became, as far as I know, the one and only female Grand Admiral of China. Was how she ended her, like Henry Morgan, she ended her career with the government instead of against it. But a great lady, no doubt about it. Yeah. I think that we'd better wrap it up. Thanks for coming.